everyone. This is Nancy Young. I'm the director of the National Center on Substance Abuse and Child Welfare, and we're delighted to be able to present this webinar today. The National Center on Substance Abuse and Child Welfare is in its 16th year. There are many resources on this topic and other topics related to substance abuse, child welfare, courts, and collaborative practice on our website. See our website link there, and we would encourage you, if you have not visited the National Center website for resources, to please do that. We are sponsored by the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration and the Children's Bureau, which is part of the Administration for Children, Youth, and Families. So thank you again, and we appreciate the sponsorship of being able to present the webinar today. We have a fairly short agenda, but hopefully much rich information. We're delighted to have Dr. Matthew Grossman present with us today to talk about the work that they have completed and still have underway in addressing the issues of infants with prenatal substance exposure, specifically infants that are maintained on medication-assisted treatment, and their efforts in their hospital. Dr. Grossman is a graduate of the State University of New York at Stony Brook School of Medicine. He completed his pediatric residency at Yale New Haven Children's Hospital. He's an assistant professor of pediatrics at the School of Medicine at Yale and a pediatric hospitalist. He's been the quality and safety officer for Yale New Haven Children's Hospital since 2013, and his team was awarded the 2015 National Pediatric Quality Award from the Children's Hospital Association. We will hear from Dr. Grossman and then have time for questions and answers. Please do submit those questions through your chat box. We have staff who are monitoring those so that we can get to as many of those questions as we can. And if we're not able to get to your question, we will have that submitted. And if you'd like to then email us also to make sure that we're able to respond to those questions, we'd be happy to be able to do that. With that, let me turn things over to Dr. Grossman. Welcome, and thank you for sharing your expertise, knowledge, and your time with us today.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here with everybody. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our experience in taking care of these substance-exposed babies and their parents on the pediatric units at Yale, and how our way of looking at this and the way of managing it has really changed quite dramatically over the last 6 or 7 years or so. So just the background, which I'm sure everybody knows, is that you're all here. We all know this is kind of a big problem, opioids in the United States. And really where it affects pediatricians, at least in the hospitals, really with what we call neonatal abstinence syndrome or neonatal opioid withdrawal syndrome. But we've seen the prescriptions grow fourfold for folks over the last decade. At least in the state of Connecticut, the leading cause of death has always been car accidents. And in the last year, there were three times as many deaths from opioid overdoses as car accidents, and car accidents haven't gone down at all. And of course, there were enough opioids in 2012, enough prescriptions for everyone to get one. So it's been a big problem somewhat from the medical community. So along with the rates of opioid use in the adult world, the rates of neonatal abstinence syndrome have gone up dramatically since 2000, increased fivefold from 2000 to 2013. And we don't have the best numbers yet, but our sense is it continued to go up over the last 5 years as well. And we've seen it spread into areas of the country where it was not quite as big of a problem. We've seen it. Big areas are West Virginia, Kentucky, Tennessee, and then in New England has been a big issue as well. So when these babies are born, and I'll go through a little bit of what they go through, but they're mostly managed in neonatal intensive care units. And an estimate in 2012 was that 4 to 5% of neonatal intensive care unit or NICU beds were filled with babies going through neonatal abstinence syndrome. In a lot of community hospitals, that percentage is closer to 50%. And because these babies will stay a long time, their average length of stay for these kids is somewhere around 3 weeks, which is down a bit, since this has become a bigger problem. 3 weeks is the longest length of stay of anything in pediatrics outside of prematurity. So the super premature babies will stay a long time. But outside of that, the really sick kids who have pneumonias and chest tubes, they don't stay as long as these babies. This is number one. So what happens to the baby? So the baby is born to a mom who's been using some sort of opioid consistently, is fairly certain to go through some kinds of withdrawal. And that's because when they're in utero, they're being exposed to this opioid all the time, and their brain sort of adjusts to that often. The sort of down-regulating effect of these opioids causes them to make a lot more receptors. And once they're born and they're no longer getting the opioid, they have this kind of overload, and usually it's things like dopamine and norepinephrine that get overloaded, and they get this sort of hyperstimulated response. It's the withdrawal signs are not that different from what you see in adults, but they've been well categorized really by this tool, which if anyone on the line has taken care of these kids, then this is a very familiar tool to you. This is what's really used almost universally to help manage these kids. And this is called the Finnegan tool. And this was developed in the mid 70s when there was a heroin epidemic in Philadelphia. And the neonatologists there were seeing lots and lots of babies going through this. And so they just studied these babies and figured out what was going on with them and what kind of signs they were having. And there's 21 items on here. And they split them into four basic categories. One was central nervous system disturbances. And on there is things like high-pitched cry, difficulty sleeping, having this hyperactive moral reflex. That's that startle reflex that all babies have. If you ever want to show it to somebody, if you show it to it and a baby going through this, it's very easy to see. It's very dramatic. These babies will tend to have tremors. They'll be shaking a little bit. And that can be whether when they're just untouched or whether you disturb them for it. They'll have this increased muscle tone. So that if you try to pick a baby up by a newborn baby by the arms, the head will lag quite a bit because the head is much heavier than the rest of the body, and they don't have much neck control at that point. But a baby going through this withdrawal will come up almost like stiff as a board. And so that's an almost universal finding you'll see with withdrawal. You'll see excoriations, which is basically really bad diaper rashes. You'll see these kind of jerks, which are called myoclonic jerks. Seizures have been reported. And then the next category is vasomotor or respiratory disturbances. Basically, everything kind of speeds up. They're sweating, they have fevers, they'll sneeze, they'll yawn, they'll have some stuffiness, they'll breathe faster. And then there's gastrointestinal issues. Again, everything's sort of speeding up. They'll be sucking a lot. They won't feed well often because they just can't get it together to feed. They're too disorganized. They'll throw up. They'll often have loose and watery stools. And so those are generally what the baby's experience. So it's a pretty miserable baby that you're faced with who starts to go through this. And it can happen anywhere from right after birth to several days into birth, because particularly if you're on a longer acting opioid like methadone, it can stay in the baby's system for a while. And so they won't start to experience withdrawal until you get a little bit further. So this is pretty standard. And all those items are given a score. And that was sort of done by the folks in 1975, just the things that seemed worse got a higher score. There wasn't anything really more scientific than that. And in terms of monitoring and managing these babies, they would add up the scores, and they decided on a score of 8 being the kind of magic number. If you're above 8 or a couple scores in a row, then we started medication on these babies. And the standard approach to care for these kids has really been not a ton of variation, really, since this scoring tool came out in 1975. And the idea is these babies would be born. They would mostly go to the neonatal intensive care unit, sometimes in other areas, but mostly in neonatal intensive care units. They would be scored somewhere between 2 and 6 hours with this Finnegan tool. And if they got 3 scores of 8 in a row, you would start them on medication. Now, you were supposed to do things like just kind of regular baby things we would call non-pharmacologic care, where you're holding the baby, feeding them when they're hungry, those kinds of things. But really what was thought of as the key to treatment was the medication you gave them. And a lot of the research over the years has been trying to figure out what the right medication or the right combination of medications are that are going to have the best outcomes for these kids. And usually what was considered to be the best outcomes were the shortening the length of stay in the hospital, because again, these were the longest lengths of stay of anything we have in pediatrics, or lowering the time that you were treating them with these medications, which aren't necessarily entirely safe. And so that's mostly what we were looking at. And so our experience at Yale, we had the benefit of going through most of these medications. In the 70s, we were using something called paregoric, which is my favorite one because it looks like something that no one should ever take. It's got all this stuff in it. It's has about 30% alcohol. It's got little things floating in it. It's got camphor, other carcinogenics in it. I'm not sure why we landed on that one early on. But we eventually moved to something called tincture of opium, which is just basically a plain form of opium. And the recommendations for this are basically to give back a like medication. So if you're withdrawing from an opioid, like heroin or methadone, then you give back similarly an opioid. And so this was the study listed at the bottom was from Germany, where they compared giving this tincture of opium to phenobarbital and found, which is usually a seizure medication and tends to sedate kids. So it was really not treating the withdrawal, but would sedate children. And they found that they had a better outcomes when they used the tincture of opium. Next, we actually moved on to morphine in the 90s. That was just sort of a change by our pharmacy. And there were some studies, one from Scotland, comparing morphine to tincture of opium, which found to have similar results, which would be expected. What you will find a lot of places will do is they'll use something like morphine or tincture of opium. Really, most places are using morphine now. They'll use morphine and then they'll add phenobarbital if things aren't going that well. They have to really go to high doses of morphine. They'll add phenobarbital. But there are still some places that will use phenobarbital as a first-line treatment, but not that many. So this was a study from Brown in Rhode Island. And what they did is they gave some kids tincture of opium and they gave some other kids tincture of opium plus phenobarbital. And what they found is the kids who got the phenobarbital from the start, they had half the length of stay of the kids who just got tincture of opium. So it was a really powerful study. And reviews that looked at all of the studies found like this was the most powerful one. This is probably what we should be doing. That was in 2002. Another thing that's come up a lot lately, and there's a big study going on or just finished that compared giving morphine to methadone. And this is a study from Maine, which you don't get to stay all that often because there's not a lot of people in Maine, but those who are there have NAS apparently. And so they compared methadone to morphine and found that the kids treated with methadone actually did a little bit better than the kids treated with morphine. And then one of the things that we were interested in, one too many, was a study that came from Johns Hopkins where they gave clonidine, which is something that's used in adults for withdrawal. And they were giving that along with their morphine. And that's just supposed to kind of blunt the signs of withdrawal. And they found when they gave the kids tincture of opium and clonidine, they did a little bit better and had a shorter length of stay than the kids who just got tincture of opium. So that's kind of a crash course in what the medications look like. And that's really just trying to figure out what maybe there's one better than the other, or maybe a combination will really work well. And that was kind of the standard approach. So the standard approach, again, to go over it was really even though the you're supposed to do the non-pharmacologic stuff of holding the babies. But if you had a baby like in this picture, you were giving them medication, and now it's usually morphine, but methadone's getting a little more popular. They would mostly be managed in neonatal intensive care units, or NICUs. They would be managed using that Finnegan tool, which is it makes it much easier. You can just follow the scores, and it tells you exactly what to do. There's not a lot of decision making going on. And then once you started the medication, when you started to lower it, you would do it very slowly. You usually go down by about 10% every day or every other day. So it would be a pretty slow wean that would take usually weeks. And you would only go down if the kid had all their scores below 8. And then really in a NICU, if anyone's been in a NICU setting, the staff really owns these babies, which is really to the benefit of the babies a lot of times. But it's really the staff caring for the babies, not so much the parents in most of the models. And there's a real ownership. And as a resident who used to, who would, you know, as a new doctor who worked in the NICU, if I ever examined, there was one time I examined a baby without getting permission from the nurse. And that was the one and only time I did that. And I would never do that again. So help me God. So it's an intimidating group and they own their babies. So that's kind of the deal. And this is pretty much what we were doing at Yale. So we, one of the only differences when these babies were born, they would go directly from the delivery room to the NICU and they'd be monitored using the Finnegan score. The one thing is our NICU was a little bit small at that time. So after about a week or 10 days, when the NICU folks felt they had stabilized their dose of morphine, they would transfer them up to the general inpatient unit, which is where I work. So I'm not a neonatologist. I take care of just general sick kids in the hospital. They would transfer them up to me at about 7 to 10 days. And that's kind of how I got involved taking care of these kids. This was not a population I was interested in. It was kind of a population that I got stuck with. I got, there was another hospitalist in our group and he had 1 year of seniority over me and he got to pick the floor where these babies didn't go. And that was the main reason he did that. So, they were kind of easy to take care of. We would sit and when we rounded on them, the residents would just read off the Finnegan scores and we would say go up or down on the medications. And our average length of stay when I started was about 28 days, which was not so far out the norm, around that time. And so, but one of the things that we did, as a hospitalist, we tend to try to get patients out of the hospital. So what I did is I kind of fudged the part where we would go down on the medication really slowly. We used to go down every other day if they had good scores. And I used to sort of fudge that and go down every day. So what happened was, somebody took a look at our data and found that from, before I started, our length of stay was 28 days. And then just by kind of fudging things a little bit, we went to 22 and a half days, which is actually almost right at the national average at the time. Now, again, this wasn't a population that we had a protocol. We followed it. There wasn't much to think about. In fact, one of my predecessors used to take the Finnegan scores at the end of the week and play the lottery for the residents to try to keep it interesting. There wasn't a lot of thinking to go on. We didn't see the parents very much. When we did, it was kind of, they were usually difficult interactions. We sort of looked forward to the fact that they wouldn't be there very often. And then at the end of the hospitalization, we would kind of hand the baby over to the parents and say, okay, you're ready to go home tomorrow. And oftentimes we would hear, oh my gosh, we're not ready to go yet. We need another day. We don't have a crib. We need to, you know, we're not ready. And so, which always sort of blew us away because we've been here for 4 weeks and, you know, we didn't see much of the parents and they weren't ready to go. But at any rate, so we had lowered our length of stay. And what happened was one of our, local hospitals, Middlesex Hospital, which is about 45 minutes away from us, they found out that we had reduced our length of stay, and I think they had a length of stay of about 6 weeks at the time. So they wanted me to come and give them a talk about how we had been so successful in reducing our length of stay. And I said, okay, but I really only had about 90 seconds of material. I had our protocol and I had the thing about the lottery. That's about all I had to tell. So I had to go and do all this reading, which was a real bummer, but you know, it was reasonable. So as I read all these studies, one thing sort of came to light. If I line up all the studies that I mentioned earlier, this kind of an interesting thing comes up. And if you look actually, and DTO is the diluted tincture of opium. So it's a little hard to make out now, but if you look if you line up all these different studies, which are really all the same types of patients, same exposures, and they're supposed to be these kind of same protocols, if you could follow through the kids who got morphine, the length of stay ranged in these studies from 8 days. There's one that was 8 days, one that was 24 days, and one that was 30 days. And if you look for the tincture of opium, it was actually 17 days versus 27 days versus 79 days. So that's a spread that you just don't see in any other disease process. That's crazy. The idea that you have these same protocols and in one place it would be a length of stay of 17 days and the other it would be 79 days makes no sense. That is crazy. And so I thought, well, why is that? Why is that happening? And of course I didn't know, but, the first thing that came to mind for me is that, well, maybe it's really not about the medications. As I mentioned, the first line treatment is supposed to be this non-pharmacologic care where you kind of hold the baby and feed them when they're hungry and that kind of stuff. And if you go and look at the AAP guidelines, they list that stuff first, and they spend 52 words on that. And then they spend 1,656 words on the medication parts of it. So it's kind of, you know, if you think about what goes on in a neonatal intensive care unit, they're taking care of kids who are born like 3 or 4 months early. They're putting tubes in these impossibly small babies and saving their lives. And the idea that, you know, putting a pacifier in and bouncing a baby is real medical care is probably a little bit of a tough sell. So it was kind of something that was just given lip service to. And in fact, when I went back and looked at all of those studies, that most of them mention that non-pharmacologic care is the first line treatment and then don't say anything else about it. So they don't say if they delivered it or how often, were the parents there, were they not there? And if you tried to do that the other way, if you tried to do a study where you wanted to look at swaddling and see if that had an effect and you just said, you know, some of these kids got morphine. I don't know which ones or for how long, but we, you know, it's fine. Everyone would laugh at you if you tried to publish that. But it was fine because it's non-pharmacologic care and that's not real. And so what we did is we started just saying something very non-controversial and just saying, well, what if we just treat non-pharmacologic care if it's a real thing? So just treat it like it was. And so we looked at how often we were giving kids morphine. And this is just actually the data I'm going to show you is for kids exposed to methadone. We did the same approach to all of our kids. About 80% of our kids are methadone exposed. The reason I singled them out is they tend to have the worst withdrawal, which may come as a surprise to some. It's actually the heroin withdrawal is not as bad on the babies as the methadone withdrawal. So these are the ones that we could be certain we're going to go through significant withdrawal. And so we looked at this from 2003 to 2010. It's about 150 kids at that time. And it's actually gotten, we have far more of them now. 98% of them were treated with morphine. So that means that 98% of them had three Finnegan scores of greater than 8. So, and this is, I'm going to show you these a few times. These are called control charts. And this is a way to sort of follow your progress. I'm going to try to orient you to this a little bit. So each of the black lines or the bouncing lines, each one of those points is a patient and their length of stay. So this is the length of stay of these babies. And so of the methadone exposed babies. So that's each one. The white line going across is the average for us. So that was 22 and a half days. And the green line is the, of the recent studies, is the lowest length of stay I could find in a big study, and that was the Vermont Oxford Network, which was 199 hospitals that really worked to reduce the length of stay and got it down to 19 days. And then the red lines are what's called control limits, and that's three standard deviations from the mean, which really means that 99% of your value should fall within those red lines. And so when you're trying to decrease the length of stay and improve how you care for kids like this, you want to see two things happen. You want to see that white line, which is the average line, go down. And you also want to see the red line get a little bit tighter, which means you'll have less variation. There's less space between the two red lines. So those are the things we're going for. So this is 2008 to 2010. This is where we started. 22 and a half days, quite a bit of variability, pretty normal compared to other places. So what we started to do when we went through this is to really think about why we were doing all the things we were doing, which is kind of an unusual thing in medicine. There's a million papers published every month. It's hard to keep up on everything. When you have protocols and you have guidelines, usually you go with them. But we started to just question why we were doing the things we were doing. So why were we using medications? Why were we doing all of the standard things we were doing? And what we found as we looked into all of these things, that we found out that there was the same answer for every part of the treatment we were doing. The reason we were doing the things we were doing today was simply because that's what we were doing yesterday. And there was really no other evidence behind it. And it got a little disappointing as we delved more and more into it, but it was a little bit freeing for us to try to think about a different way to do this. So why were medications considered really the treatment? And in fact, lots of places don't consider a baby to have neonatal abstinence syndrome unless you give them medication, which is kind of a made up definition and doesn't really make any sense. So in other words, if you make improvements in non-pharmacologic care so that you don't have to give them medication, it doesn't count in your treatment of neonatal abstinence syndrome. sort of nonsensical. So we thought, why are medications the first line treatment, even though everything you read says it is? So we started to just say, okay, we're going to really focus on non-pharmacologic care. And there's some data to support this, particularly from Vancouver, where instead of taking the babies, now, if you're listening to this stuff and feeling like some of this stuff seems like common sense, I'm right there with you. This is, I think of this as one of the least innovative projects that you can find, even though it's, you know, if you take care of these kids, you think it's really innovative. And if you don't take care of them in the hospital, you think we're all kind of a bunch of idiots. And I think those people are probably right. So what they did in Vancouver, they just kept the babies and moms together. And it turned out, hey, that went kind of well, which shouldn't be a giant surprise. And so we started to do that. We started to think about what it meant to do non-pharmacologic care. And you have these kids who are hyperstimulated. And so keeping them in a low stimulation environment is really important, and try not to mess with them too much. And so anytime you change their diaper or give them a bath, it's kind of a big experience for them. And usually they won't go all that well. These babies need to be fed a lot. They have a couple of reasons. One, it's a soothing thing for them. And also they're using a lot of energy. So they're, you remember I mentioned they're sort of stiff as a board and they're doing all these things in there. So they're using a ton of energy. So they often need a lot more calories than babies not going through this. And so what we would always say is we want to feed them when they're hungry, which does not seem that radical. And so we were really good at feeding babies in the NICU on demand, as long as that demand was exactly every 3 hours. So if you've ever been in a NICU, it's very regimented. And so you would hear all the time, well, he seems hungry. It's 2 hours and 30 minutes, and he seems hungry, but he's not due to eat yet, so he's not eating until he's due to eat, which is really not how babies work, and was not really a good fit for these kids. So doing things like feeding them when they're hungry, which could be every 45 minutes for periods of time. They may eat very frequently, and they also might need to be held quite a bit, which is not really fit in a NICU environment. And they also, one of the things that happens, if they start to get upset and they start to cry, a lot of the withdrawal signs can really snowball from that. So if you can tend to them right away, then you can really short circuit a lot of these signs from snowballing. If you're a nurse who has five babies and one of them starts to cry and you have to give medications to the other two, it might be 20 minutes before you can get to that crying baby, in which case things have really fallen apart at that time. So what we found is really, if you want to feed the kids whenever they're hungry, and which can be really frequently, and you want to be able to respond to them within seconds, it's got to be somebody who's at the bedside all the time. And that's not going to be a staff member. That has to be a family member. So if we're really going to deliver this non-pharmacologic care successfully, now we can control the lights and the noise to some degree, but if we're going to be able to do that, we really need a parent or a family member at the bedside. So we started to focus on that a lot more. And just by doing that, we reduced our length of stay from 22 and a half days down to about 13 days. So that is a really dramatic decrease in length of stay. So if that were a pill, then we would make sure everybody got that pill. And that's sort of how we started to think about it. We started to think about it like asthma. So if you have an asthma attack, they make you take one of those inhalers, those albuterol inhalers. You come to the hospital, that's what we give you. It would be crazy to think that we wouldn't give you that. That's the treatment. So we started to think of it in terms of, okay, let's think of the mom as the albuterol for asthma. And just have that same mindset. So when we started to think about that, we started to say, okay, well, we're bringing these kids to our NICU, which now we built a new NICU that has space for parents to room in. But prior to that, we were in one of these NICUs that has 12 babies in a room. Which is kind of the old standard model, which most places are like that, at least big rooms with lots of babies in them and no place for the families. So if there's no place for the family to stay, then you can't really deliver that first line treatment. And it would be like sticking an asthmatic in a unit that doesn't carry albuterol, which is crazy. You would never do that. And so we try to think, well, why do these kids go to the NICU? What's the reason that we would keep them in the NICU? So they're not, you know, NICUs are mostly, they're doing life-saving things. It's an intensive care unit. So they're putting tubes and lines in. And so these kids don't need any of that. And so what was the reason that they were in the NICU? And the answer was, because that's where they've always been. There wasn't really any other great reason for it. One of the reasons it brought up is they might have seizures. And that comes from a study from the early 70s And then when we actually, one of the authors of that works in our system, we asked him about it. And he said, yeah, you know, we weren't really sure if those were seizures. And if you look at the follow-up studies, nobody reports seizures. That's not really a concern for these kids. So there's really no reason at all these kids should be in a neonatal intensive care unit other than we've always done it that way, which is not a good reason. It ends up being, when you look at things like this, what people call standard of care isn't actually a standard of care. It's a traditional care, which is very, very different because this is not backed by any evidence. So we looked at our NICU, and this is kind of our website photo where everyone looks happy and it's bright. You notice it's bright and it's bustling. And there's a lot of people around. I snuck in and just took kind of a cell phone photo of it. And you can see this is not a very welcoming place for a family. So there's 12 babies in there. You can see there's obviously no place for a family to stay, and it does not look very welcoming for any parent to be there. You can see there's a little curtain up there. So that's your privacy. So really unwelcoming to families and really a good laboratory of a place where you can deliver almost no non-pharmacologic care. You can swaddle a baby. They're going to be fed every 3 hours. It's bright. It's bustling. It's loud. They're going to get really no other care. And so that's why we saw the results we saw. Now, if you go to the general inpatient unit, we don't have necessarily the nicest rooms, but you can, at least one person can sleep there. There's a refrigerator. You can control the environment entirely. It just has you and your baby in the room. So a much better environment to be able to deliver this non-pharmacologic care. So we said, okay, why are these babies going to the NICU? Let's have them not go to the NICU. And so we said, instead of them being born and going right to the NICU, let's have them stay with their moms in the nursery. And then, you know, if the baby starts to have withdrawal signs, we'll have them come to our general inpatient unit. And if everything's going well and the mom gets discharged, since we don't have a lot of room in our nursery, they both can come down together. But the idea is we want to keep the mom and baby together. This was not a popular move. Our nursery, who had not had to take care of these babies and families, was not really that eager for the most part to take part in that. And so it took us 18 months of negotiating. And I think it was the first 5 babies that were born all had some other medical problem right away that caused them to be sent to the NICU. That medical problem resolved within minutes of being in the NICU. So it's actually just sort of a protest vote. That has changed so dramatically in that unit, where they are really the leaders in this now, in our hospital. So I'll get back to that later. But it was really the change from this sort of going in unwillingly to really being the leader has been amazing. So we started to do that, and you can see that white line keeps going down further. And actually, the average got down to 10.2 days. Now, you will notice that there seems to be more outliers in that group, and the red lines have spread out. And what happened there is our census in our NICU during that time was really low. And so when they were getting these babies, they were keeping them all the way through the hospitalization. And so they were having this really long length of stay because they were still doing the traditional model. They didn't even know we were doing anything at this point. We were just kind of doing this quietly on our unit and just kind of experimenting and seeing what things would work better. And having quite a bit of success. So then we were on a roll, and we started considering our Finnegan scores. So we asked why, you know, this is what everybody's using. It felt like it's the law of the land. And so there's a couple issues with it. So here's one of the, there's a few problems. And if you look at the things on this list, it's a really good description of what withdrawal looks like in a baby. Now, here's the thing. I've seen about 500 kids exposed to methadone, and every one of them has had withdrawal. So I don't really need this tool to tell me they're going to have withdrawal. And is it really helpful to count how often somebody is yawning or sneezing in order to decide whether they need these really powerful and potentially dangerous medications? Medications like phenobarbital have been shown to reduce IQ points. The more we study morphine in babies, not surprisingly, the less safe it is. So increasing the time that they're exposed and really the time they're going to withdraw if you keep giving them may not be a great idea. And some of it seems a little bit absurd when you get a situation where if we really look at these scores and say, okay, we've had a kid who's had 2 scores of 8. Remember, 8's the magic number. So if they get above 8 3 times, they're going to get medication. They have 2 scores of 8 and their score is 7 and they've sneezed 3 times, which of course is fine. But if they sneeze a 4th time, well, in a sort of indeterminate period of time, then they get another point and they go to 8 and they don't just get a dose of morphine. Because remember, when you start medications, it's not that you're just giving a dose. You're going through this very long weaning process. So you're talking about at least 100 doses of morphine that you get for that one extra sneeze. Probably doesn't make a lot of sense. I can tell you that we don't treat any other disease processes where we count yawns or sneezes and decide that those need extensive medical management. So the idea, and when you started to look into, well, why is 8 the magic number? And nobody, I couldn't find that. It took me a long time to dig it up. But the original 1975 paper says an infant with a score of 7 was not treated with drugs for the abstinence syndrome because in our experience, he would recover rapidly with swaddling and demand feeding. Infants whose score was 8 or above were treated pharmacologically. So if you ask anybody, no one knows why they use 8. They just know that they use 8. And it comes from this paragraph, never been studied further. No one knows if this is the right number or what it means. It's just what they picked in 1975, and it's what everyone's been doing, and it's now 2018. So another sort of disappointing thing we discovered. So a couple problems with using this tool. So long length of stay and lots of medication. So we know by using this score and using the system we've done, we've created the longest length of stay in it with anything in pediatrics, and we use lots and lots of medication. The whole purpose of the treatment is to just get the scores below 8. So I don't even need to see the baby as a physician. I just need to look at the scores and know that they're below 8. Now, a couple of the other things, when you look at, you may have noticed with these scoring tools, with a scoring tool, that if you've had a baby that, hey, my baby did some of these things. And that's not, that is definitely true. And one of the pictures I showed in the beginning was actually my kid who was born around this time, who was really helpful. Which is, I can look at it that way. He was a really difficult baby, and he had a lot of these signs. He was not going through withdrawal. He was just kind of a miserable baby. He's a very pleasant 8-year-old now. He's a lovely guy now, but he was tough at that point. And I thought about as I'm pacing the halls in the middle of the night that if I went into the pediatrician and said, "Hey, what dose of phenobarbital are you going to give him?" They sort of would have made fun of me. But for kids, if we said it was a withdrawal, we would have loaded him up immediately. Now there are three things on that scoring tool that are really pretty specific to withdrawal. So in other words, you don't really see those outside of withdrawal. One is that hypertonic thing, that really stiff thing. You don't really see that outside of it. That that really exaggerated Moro reflex, that sort of startle reflex that all babies have. That's, you don't really see that as exaggerated as it is in withdrawal. And then the tremors or the shaking is you can see that sometimes in other disease processes, but it's pretty specific to this as well. So, so how do you know if a baby has one of these startle reflexes that's exaggerated? Well, the only way you can do it, and the only way you can do the Finnegan score, is actually to unwrap the baby and disturb them. So you actually have to try to get them to withdraw. Even though the treatment is supposed to be keeping them calm and quiet, in order to do the score, you have to kind of mess with them and see if you can get them to withdraw so you can write the scores down. So how do you know, if they're going to have tremors when they're disturbed? Well, you have to disturb them. So actually doing this type of scoring tool is actually doing harm to the babies. It doesn't make any sense. And it's giving you information that you don't actually care about. Nobody cares about how often somebody sneezes. It can also be slow to respond. So we would do these scores every 4 hours. And so you could have a baby who's really having a difficult time and has a score of 10 at, say, noon. And then you come back at 4 and they got another score of 10. And they got a score of 10 at 8 o'clock because they're really still miserable. And that's when you can intervene. So you don't do anything for 8 hours. That's really slow. And then it's, of course, these powerful and potentially harmful meds to give to a treatment. Treat a sneeze or a yawn, which is sort of silly. It's a really good catalog of the signs of withdrawal. I'm not sure it's really at all useful in the treatment. So we started to think about it and we said, we don't want to do this. We want to start to think about what do we care about? We know these babies are going through withdrawal. We want to make sure they do okay. So we thought about, well, what's the job description of a baby at this age? They don't do very much. So they can't drive yet. They can basically, they're supposed to be able to eat, and they're supposed to be able to sleep, and they're supposed to be able to poop, which usually isn't a problem with these kids. And you should be able to calm them down. This is, if you had a colicky kid, usually it doesn't start right at birth. So usually that goes a couple of weeks into life before that. So you should be able to calm down a baby at this age. And so we said, if you can do that, so we could ask, can the baby eat? Can the baby sleep? And can the baby be consoled? So eat, sleep, and console. Which suspiciously is really the thing that we focus on in any baby. So and we work in one of these health systems where you can decide to change something and then 2 years later it actually changes. So we actually took advantage of that this time. So we decided to stop using the Finnegan score, but our protocol said to keep doing it, and we had to go through all these hoops to get it actually removed. So what we did is we stopped using it to manage the babies and started using an eat, sleep, console approach, but we were still getting the scores so we could kind of compare what we were doing versus what would happen if we used that Finnegan score. So we looked at 50 babies, and we still did the Finnegan scores basically every 4 hours. And the FNAS is the Finnegan Neonatal Abstinence Scoring System. But we didn't use them to guide management. And we used the management decisions based on the Eat, Sleep, Console, or ESC model. And so what we look for is the number of kids that we actually gave morphine to versus the number we would have had we used Finnegan. In other words, the number that had 3 scores of 8. And we looked how often they disagreed. So how often we didn't give the kid morphine as Finnegan would have told us to, and then what happened the following day when that happened. So if we didn't give morphine and these kids got much, much worse because we didn't give them morphine, we wanted to know about that. So here's what we found. We found that of the 50 kids, only 6 of them in this group actually got morphine, whereas 62%, which is right around what the national average is, would have gotten morphine if we use the Finnegan approach. That's a big difference. That's 25 kids who didn't get morphine who would have. And again, it's not a dose of morphine. It would have been weeks of morphine. And so there were actually 78 days where we gave less morphine than Finnegan told us to. And on 70% of those days, the score was better the next day, and it was better by overall by an average of about a point. And there were actually 2 cases where it went the other direction, where we gave morphine and the Finnegan said everything was fine. And the following day, even though we gave morphine, the score increased by 1.7 points the next day. So it would actually work both ways, but obviously most often it works that we give less. There were no readmissions. There were, of course, no seizures, no ICU transfers. These kids all did well. So this is, an NAS baby who, again, we would look at, and a lot of places would say, well, I'll give that kid morphine. We'd give that kid methadone. So if we ask the question, well, what would you do for this baby if it wasn't an NAS baby? The answer is pretty easy. You would probably pick this baby up. I told you this wasn't going to be that complicated. So what we really said, really our guiding, we had a couple guiding principles, and one of them is to pretend it's a baby. So really what we had been doing is taking these really miserable babies, babies who are really having a hard time, and separating them from their moms. These moms who are going through a pretty tough time, who were either in a maintenance program or not in a maintenance program, but dealing with these issues as well, and we are separating the mom and baby. And the baby is doing what's happening in this picture, and we are treating that with morphine and leaving them in the box. So our major mantra was pretend it's a baby. What would you do if it were a baby and not an NAS baby? And it turns out that if you treat them like babies, they respond like babies. So we started to look even further at what we were doing and why were we going down on the medication every day or every other day. So what was it about the earth rotating once on its axis that meant that's when we go down on the medication? It had nothing to do with how the medications are treated by the body. It's just what was done. So once again, it was one of these things where we couldn't find any reason, nor can anybody else. So we said, okay, well, what's happening when we get these babies, if they've been on medication and they come out, because we still have some kids who go to the NICU because they had other medical problems, or they come from an outside hospital. Well, what happened when they were coming to our unit is we were greatly increasing the non-pharmacologic care, which is the first line treatment, and we were now treating it with that kind of respect. So couldn't we just go down on the morphine a lot faster? It took us a long time to figure that out, which seems very obvious. And then so instead of going with weeks, we would be able to get them off in a couple of days. And then we thought, well, why are we even doing it that way? Because we have the situation where you have a baby who, say at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, is really having a hard time. And we're having difficulty consoling the kid. So the first thing we do is not to give medication, but we go and see, hey, can we increase the non-pharmacologic care? Is mom there? So no, mom actually stepped out. Well, let's get her back. And she comes back and everything's fine. But in a situation where that's not the case, where the mom had to go out She's going to have to get her methadone. She's not going to be back for a couple of hours. And the baby, we've done everything we can. We can't console the baby. We would give a dose of morphine. Now, normally that would mean you're giving morphine again for 100 doses at least. But we said, okay, well, that's 3 o'clock. Now at 6 o'clock, mom's back. Baby's calm, eating well, sleeping well, consolable. We don't give any more medication. So that's a big deal. So one dose was now one dose. We get PRN means as needed. So we gave the morphine as needed instead of going through this long made up weaning process that would take weeks and keep the baby in the hospital. So here's what we saw then. Again, so we can see that the green line stays at 19 days. The white line is now down to 7 days, which is much lower than you'll see. And actually our 3 standard deviations, so really all of our points fall well below the national average. We weren't done yet. So we looked at and this is kind of an important one. So we looked at our model and how staff was caring for the baby. We were still doing a lot of the work. There were more parents staying. At the beginning of the project, I can remember a couple of parents who actually stayed in the beginning of this project. But we were getting more and more parents staying. And I had read this paper that came out of San Antonio that did, and there's been a few papers like this where they interviewed the moms and their experiences going through this. And it was really pretty heartbreaking. And I'm going to read a couple of the quotes to you. And so how do moms feel? So first of all, there are basically 4 themes. Addiction is misunderstood. I'm sure a lot of people on the call are really understand addiction well. I certainly don't. No one goes into pediatrics really because they're excited to it, much less neonatal medicine. What I know from addiction is from watching The Wire and Trainspotting. And that's really about it. Folks in the NICU do not understand it at all. And people, and the mindset is very much like, I can't believe they made these decisions, not understanding really about this as a disease. The moms feel guilty. They don't need anyone to tell them that what they were taking, even if it was prescribed, is having their baby go through this. They felt judged by the nursing staff. And there have been a number of these studies too, where they've interviewed nurses and their experience in taking care of these babies. And the nurses said, yeah, we're judging them. So it seemed to line up really nicely. And they felt that the moms didn't trust the nurses because they were being judged and felt like they were really unwelcome. And so here are some of the quotes. His nurse was like, his muscles are locking up because of his junkie mom. I didn't want to visit. I would call before, and if that nurse was there, I wouldn't even go. So imagine having a newborn baby and not feeling welcome and not feeling comfortable visiting. The idea of visiting a newborn baby is crazy to begin with, but the idea that you weren't welcome to. Because we're going to leave, he's going to cry, and they're going to leave him crying because they're going to be like, you know what? His parents are jerks. I'm going to read you one more longer one. That's really, I think, pretty powerful. So I would just tell the nurses to take it easy on the mother. You know, after being addicted, I realized that this is really a disease. There are some who abuse, but if you're using while you're pregnant, you have a problem, a big problem, and you need help. You obviously don't care about yourself, about anything except the drug. Make it a little bit easier on that mother if she's showing initiative. She's taking the time to be there. If she loves her child, you can see it and you can feel it. If it's obvious that she's there for the baby, then embrace it. Make it easier. You don't know what her circumstances are. You don't know what she's been through or how hard her life has been. You don't know what she was feeling when she was pregnant. If she was being abused, if she was poor, whatever the reason she was using while she was pregnant, you just don't know. So try to make it easier for her. So we heard her. So that was, we said, we do not want anyone feeling this way in our hospital. So we thought about how we were talking about neonatal abstinence syndrome. We talked about how we thought about how we were approaching the parents and discussing it with them, and we changed it and we made it a lot more positive. And we looked at our role really as our job is to empower the parents, and really where the medical management was really quite minimal. And really what we were doing is really being coaches and cheerleaders and all this. And so it turns out, you know, we thought it really what we were trying to do with this is trying to make this go better for the baby and the mom, both in the hospital and when they went home. And so if you remember what we were doing in the beginning is we were taking these babies and at 28 days saying, hey, it's time to go home. And the parents were saying, oh, we're not ready to go home. We don't know how to do this. They hadn't bonded with the baby. They hadn't been there. We had been taking care of the baby. They'd been doing whatever they'd been doing. And so now we start prenatally going over the mom and the dad if they're there. And I often say mom, but sometimes it's been a single dad or it's oftentimes mom and dad together. or it can be a grandparent, it can be anything. We say, look, this is what your baby needs. You are the treatment for your baby. We know that they're going to feel guilty, but what we're able to tell them is you are the treatment for your baby. Not even some of the places that do this well have messaged this as saying, the non-pharmacologic care is really important. If that doesn't work, then we give medication. So we would never say that. We'd say, no, this is the first line treatment. This is what works. You are the treatment for your baby. There are times where some of these babies have a tougher reaction to it where you'll be 90% of the treatment and we'll need to give medication for a short period of time, which will just help, but you're still the key to treatment. It's all about you. And so, you could see the parents stand up a little straighter. We would hear that, I wanted to deliver here because I heard you respect moms going through this. And we thought about what we were doing. And I've heard other places who are starting to change saying, oh, well, do you guys have a contract for the mom? And our answer is, well, do you have a contract for other moms? And the answer is, of course, no. And so we certainly don't have one for these moms. So we really, we treat the babies like babies and we treat the moms like moms. So it's really the main thrust of our treatment is treating the babies like babies and respecting the moms and respecting the folks going through this. And what we've seen is for the staff, these were the hardest babies for the staff to take care of. When you look at some of those NICU nurse interviews, they say they're taking care of these impossibly small kids and they have a lot of deaths in the NICUs. They would list these babies as their toughest to take care of because of the experience with the families. The same thing on the floor, you have these very difficult babies, the family's not there very much. And suddenly, when the family's there and doing all the care, this becomes one of the easier patients for the staff to take care of. The parents are doing all the work. It's not our job. It's our job to support the family. And we used to see things like, hey, the mom's really sleepy, so I'm going to call Child Protective Services. Or can you believe that mom? The baby was crying and she couldn't wake up. So, well, yeah, you know, she's on methadone and her dose is about 30% higher than she's used to. Plus, she's a new mom, so she has lots of reasons to be extra sleepy. So what would we do if she wasn't on methadone? We would probably figure out ways to support her. So that's what we started to do. Instead of saying, oh, well, she didn't wake up, saying, listen, we know you're doing such a great job. You need your rest too. Usually the baby wakes up at about 2 to feed. Why don't I take that feed and you can sleep and then we'll get you up for the next one. So just thinking of ways we could support people just like they were moms and taking the judgment out of it. We really took to heart what that one mom said. We don't know what they're going through, but we know it's not going to help if we're judging or not being supportive. We want to give them their best chance, and that comes from us partnering. And it frankly makes our lives a lot better as well. So there are situations where the moms aren't there, the family's not there. There are ones where there's no interest from the family. They're going to be giving the baby up. Or where they just can't be there. They've tried everything and they have 3 other kids at home. They have no other resources and we've tried the best we can to help. And so what we found is that doesn't change what the baby needs. These babies need to be loved. They need to be treated like babies. And so we have an army of folks who can fill in where necessary. We look at it as it sort of takes a village. So I always assign a medical student to those cases. I watch SportsCenter during lunch, sit with the baby. Our nurse manager has an office where she can turn the lights out and keep the baby if necessary. We figure out how to do the best we can if the parent can't be there because we know that's what the baby needs. The sooner we can get them to somebody who's going to love them, even if it's a foster family, that's what this baby needs. So just to summarize what we went through, and I'll go over our data a little bit more. With the old protocol, it was really the whole purpose was to suppress withdrawal signs. And I had to examine the babies, but I didn't really need to. It didn't make any difference. I didn't need to talk to the families. We're just trying to get those withdrawal signs down. Now it's really the goal is to have the baby be a baby, do what babies do. We know they're going to have withdrawal, but if we can manage it okay, then we've had success. So the old model, you had a NICU where the mom would visit. Here, we manage the mother and child together. And so that's our way we do it. And there's different ways we do it in the different hospitals in our system. So we have our main hospital. We may be able to change it a little bit, even though I don't really want to. We could have these kids go to the NICU because you can room in now. But I think we've done such a good job of changing the culture on the floor, we're probably not going to do that. But if we go to we have another hospital where we have a deliveries, which is about a mile away. And they have, when these babies are born there, if the mom and baby can stay together and they really have one room we're after the mom's discharge where they can stay. And so if they can go in that room, great. If not, they transfer them over to us so we can keep the mom and baby together. That's the crux of it. So each hospital may have different challenges, but that's what you have to end up with. That's the starting point. How do you keep the mother and child together? And if you can't, then you probably can't manage these babies in your hospital. This is surmountable. You can figure this out. Finnegan scores. It was all about treating the number. Again, just looked at the number and followed. It was very easy. Here, it's really eat, sleep, console. So treating, we have to ask, with the Finnegan score approach, you didn't actually ask how the infant was doing. And eat, sleep, console, the first question to the mom is, how's the baby doing? And what was really interesting, I went to Dartmouth. So Dartmouth does an amazing job. Their non-pharmacologic care, the stuff, how they support their moms is really laudable. And it's probably, their infrastructure is better than ours with that. They brought a panel of moms who had gone through this, and there were five moms speaking for an hour, and all they spoke about for the whole hour was the Finnegan score and how they knew that this nurse on at night tended to score high, and they knew if they got one more score of 8 that they were gonna start meds and they were gonna be here for another 2 weeks, so that the baby would sneeze and they'd be really focused. And did anyone see that? I hope they don't get that, so they're scoring on it. So even though they were doing all this stuff, the focus and was on these Finnegan scores, it was so fraught because if you tripped over, it wasn't that you got a dose of morphine, it's that you got 100 doses minimum. And so the eat, sleep, control, you get to treat the infant, and you also get to use, if it's not such a big deal, if you need to use the morphine because you're using one dose at a time. The last, I think, three kids that we gave morphine to got a total of 8 doses combined, as opposed to what would have been at least 300. So everybody does supportive care. Everybody's protocol says non-pharmacologic care first, so do the AP guidelines, but we do it for real. We're in uppercase letters, we're zealous about it. It's the treatment. If it were a pill, everyone would use it. There would be no questions about it. Feeding on demand, again, this is surprisingly tricky in a hospital. So this has always been our trickiest thing. We just took out our feeding schedule. So it's feed the baby. And so that's worked much better. Morphine was the key to our treatment in the beginning. And now that shows up somewhere on page 3 of our protocol. So it's really not the feature of our treatment. And it's used just as an extra helper occasionally. This used to often be a surprise to families when they would come in that this was going to happen with their baby. It was kind of an uncomfortable conversation to have. And so often OBs wouldn't have them. And so now we're meeting with the families beforehand as much as possible, and going over what the expectations are and how their baby is going, what their baby's probably going to go through and how they're going to help through that. The staff used to take care of the infant, and now the staff coaches the parents. This is a really big one. So the culture change with our staff has really been remarkable. We are partners in this now. And so here's what we saw. So, and this is up through the summer. I gotta get our latest data, but when I glanced at it, it hasn't really changed. So we went from an average of 22 and a half days. And if I bring that back even further, we started at 28 days. And our average length of stay is now 5.9 days over the last 2.5 years. And the average length of stay for nationwide is 19 days using versions of the traditional approach. This is a dramatic change, and this is a disruptive approach to this, and it seems very intuitive, and it's a very common sense approach. We've had 3 babies stay longer than 12 days, or two at 12 days and one at 13 days, and those are kids who just had trouble eating, and had a little trouble. They were a little sleepy when they were eating, and we got that fixed. So that's it. And again, if we look kind of over from 2003, it's up, you know, we were up over 30 days really for a while, and then really down below 6 days. And if we look at the percent that were treated, so if you think about how we were treating 98% of these kids, the percent we're treating now is 100% aggressively from birth, not with medications, but we are treating them non-pharmacologically with swaddling, with holding, with feeding them on demand, with doing all of that stuff to treating them like a baby aggressively, not separating them from their mom, but keeping them with their mom from birth. But that means we're not really giving a whole lot of morphine. So the percent treated with morphine is actually down around below 10% now. And if we actually look in 2016, for the kids who were able to skip the NICU, eventually we got the NICU to get on board. So when they thought about starting morphine, they would just transfer the kids a little more quickly. But in 2016, for the kids who came straight to the unit, we actually didn't use morphine at all. When we do use morphine, we haven't gone up on our dose of morphine in about 5 years on the floor. So people ask me how we go up, and the answer is I don't know anymore. I try to figure it out if it ever comes up. But we find if we just give some, it's at 10% support. We can really be aggressive about our non-pharmacologic care. It doesn't have to go above that. Breastfeeding rate, we were really at nothing when we started, and we're above 50% now. There are some, we have some rules about active use and not and discouraging it. We probably have a little bit of room for improvement here, but not a whole lot. So we're pretty happy that we want to keep that going. And our average cost of care, the hospital really likes this one. This is about 95% Medicaid, which is not a great reimburser in Connecticut. And we've cut our costs by about a quarter, which has saved about $2.5 million a year in our hospital. So the suits really like it. We published our first paper on this in June of last year, and we've seen a lot of people interested in it. Boston Medical Center had been using the traditional Finnegan approach. They started to use just elements of Finnegan for about 6 months, and then they started using the Eat, Sleep, Console approach as a scoring tool, and they did that. They've been doing that for over a year now. And we didn't create a scoring tool for this because it seems sort of silly. It's just, again, the stuff that you look at for babies. So it's just regular baby care, but for some people it makes it a little bit easier. And they found their use of morphine went down from 82% to 40%. Their length of stay went from 18 days to 10 days. They weren't satisfied with this. And so they actually, a couple of months ago, they came to visit us. They brought a team down and went to see what we were doing exactly to bring it back, because they thought they could do even better than what they were doing. They've had no readmissions during their time as well. And so this is what this is an informal of people have reached out to me and said they are starting to do this since the summer, are in these states and a couple spots in Canada and also one in New Zealand, but I couldn't fit that on the map. So, and these are the ones that I know of, and there's others that are doing it as well. So it's become fairly popular, and hopefully we'll continue to extend it. We really think this is something that is just better for moms and babies, and it's treating them as they should. And it's really treating the babies kind of with love, and then treating the parents with respect. And what we've seen is certainly the parents are treating the baby, but also at least in the short term, we're seeing that the babies are really in some ways treating the parents as well. The information on long-term outcomes, how these babies do after they go home, how they do when they're 6 months old or 2 years old or 5 or 10 or 15 is really limited. And so there's a lot of interest in starting to study that a lot more. And really, does it matter how we manage them? Is it better or worse if we do it our way in the beginning? Or does that have any impact at all? We don't know. And we just don't know how these kids are as little kids, as teenagers, as adults, but there's a lot more data to come on that. So we're really looking forward to being a part of that as well. So really, to sum this up, it's really just hugs before drugs for these kids. It's empowering families. It's keeping the parents and the babies together. It's rooming in. It's actually using non-pharmacologic care as a first-line treatment. We think of it as family-centered care, not as a way to deliver treatment, but as the treatment for these babies. Thinking about getting rid of the eat, sleep, console approach, using meds only as needed. And really, it's asking for the medical approach. It's really asking why and making sure you know why you're doing all the things you're doing. And oftentimes you're not. And it's hard. Change is hard. But it's worth it. And it's not as hard when the change that you're asking for, carries a lot of, intuitiveness and common sense and evidence behind it. So it's been a big team. I only listed a few folks, but it's really been an amazing team. And a lot of the folks listed there are from our nursery, which again was so resistant in the beginning. And really one of the things that was amazing is they were supposed to be transferring babies to us when the baby started having withdrawal signs, they were still doing Finnegan scores. So when the scores got above 8, they were going to transfer them down. And after a year, we noticed that we weren't getting those babies anymore, that we were never getting them without their moms. And we went up to ask what was going on. And they said, well, look, we noticed that you guys weren't necessarily starting medication on these kids and we sent them down. And we saw how powerful it was having the mom and baby together. And we weren't going to split that up. And so this group that had been so resistant in the beginning had made these changes all on their own without any push from us and made their jobs harder, really. They saw, it meant they were managing these babies for longer, but they said they saw how powerful it was when they were empowering these moms, and they weren't going to mess with that either. So that's really amazing. So really now about half of the care that we do is really in the nursery and the other half's on the inpatient unit. So they're doing most of it, and we're just sort of finishing it up for them, but they're really have become the leaders in this. So that's been one of the more amazing things. I think we have time for questions and discussion.
Yes, thank you so much, Dr. Grossman. We've had a lot of questions come in. I want to run, and we will get to those. I want to run through a little bit of the resources because some of the questions have been specific to child welfare practice. So we will make sure that the participants in today's webinar get these resources in a PowerPoint distribution to them so that they have these to follow up with, because we've had a fair number about child welfare practice. So we have some from Children's Bureau and their information memos, from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, specific to treatment of opioids. If you're not familiar, that SAMHSA put out just a few months ago the National Guidance for Management of Pregnant and Parenting Women with Opioid Use Disorders and their infants. So we'll send that to you so you have the way to get in touch with ordering that. We also have some guidelines that are specific to the treatment of opioid use disorders in pregnancy that we want to make sure that participants have. The National Center published this a comprehensive approach to collaborative practice with child welfare, hospitals, treatment agencies, and courts based on a national work group that came out about a year and a half, almost coming up on 2 years ago. So we want to make sure that participants have that also, as well as the other National Center resources that have been published on this population and child welfare, as well as the online tutorials. We had a couple questions come in about getting CEUs. So we have a web page that's specific to basics of treatment for opioid use disorders, as well as this special population with pregnant and parenting women. So the online tutorials also relate to that with free CEUs. With that, let me turn to some questions that have come in. First, you spent some time talking about this change that happened, the culture change in the unit, and in some of your last comments about some change that was made based on the nurses and others in the NICU sending families on to you even before sort of cajoling them. What do you think that big difference was? Was it the data that they saw about the change, or what do you think that, and what would be your recommendation for other hospitals or communities about how to begin that change?
Yeah, that's a question I get a lot. And it's interesting, you know, the way that we did the change is probably isn't necessary exactly. We did this over a lot of years as we were trying to figure out each new thing to do. So there wasn't, it wasn't as unified. You know, we knew we were trying to get it better, but we didn't have a vision of exactly what this was going to look like at the end. What's been really valuable, and I mentioned in the beginning that this sort of started when I went to Middlesex Hospital to give this talk, and I had to do all this reading, which was back in 2009. And last year in November, those folks came back to visit our hospital to find out what was going on and what we were doing. And we went through all of our stuff, and we sat with a patient with them and walked around and talked to the staff. And on their 45-minute drive home, they entirely changed their protocol, starting that night. They said, we're not going to treat babies or moms the way we've been doing it for another minute. And they started changing that night. Now, most places are more measured. And, they, you know, they said it was a little bit tough over the first couple of weeks. And then everyone came on board. Look, change is hard. And not everybody's going to be on board. And a lot of other places done it much more slowly and said, okay, we're going to do this one element in June of 2019, and then we'll see. And that's probably too slow. Well, the way that I, you know, if you're waiting until you convince everybody that this is a great idea, you're never going to get there. And so I'm a proponent of the lone nut theory of this. And there's this 3-minute TED talk about the lone nut and starting a movement. And it's a picture of it's this grainy video at it looks like a concert when there's this guy dancing kind of like a lunatic on a hill. And everyone's just kind of sitting and watching the concert and kind of ignoring them. And then somebody joins them, and then somebody else joins them. And within 30 seconds, the entire hill is dancing. And so the idea was not to go and convince every person that they should get up and dance. It was just to start and get a couple of early adopters. Then you start to see that. And then as more people add, you start to become the minority when you're not part of it. And so just starting, so not waiting until everyone's convinced, but finding a group that's going to do this. This is better in every way. It's better for the staff. It feels better. It removes the anger from this. It's so much better for the families, and that's very easy to see. So I would just find some people who are interested and get started that way.
That's terrific. Great advice to all of us to get started and bring them on. As you can. We recognize the contributions from Dr. Finnegan from so many years ago before Subutex was available, but have you worked with families, with moms that have been using Subutex, buprenorphine during pregnancy? Do you see any differences in the expression of the NAS symptoms during that, with the differences?
Yeah, and this has been borne out for the most part from the data. It seems to be generally less severe. Not on 100% of cases, but there are the length of stays tend to be short. For us, it's a little hard to tease it out, but we certainly see kids who don't appear to be going through withdrawal. I'm a little skeptical of a lot of the studies because it's unclear what kind of non-pharmacologic care they're doing, which we've shown is so important that it's hard to make a lot of conclusions from those studies, but my experience is certainly that it tends to be less severe on the babies. Methadone, as I mentioned, is the hardest and is the worst withdrawal. That's about 80% of our patients, and about 15% are Subutex, and that's been going up over the last few years.
Okay, thanks for that. The article that came out almost a year ago, you published specifically to mothers that were on methadone and during pregnancy. What's been your experience with moms who were not on medication-assisted treatment but using illegal substances or non-prescribed opioids, perhaps the population that's not engaged in treatment and potentially less compliant?
Yeah. So our approach has been no different whatsoever. So we are not, there is somebody's job, which is usually our child protective services, to sort of judge that. That is not my job, and that is good. And so I just get to, and I know what's best for the baby with this is to be with their mom. And so as long as somebody thinks it's not dangerous at that time, and we are doing exactly the same thing. And so, and what we have heard from our child protective services is that they have been actually taking fewer of our babies away from their families because they're seeing them with the baby. And that is adding to their a little bit more information for them. If they're sort of on the fence and not sure, that's tipping it over to often keeping them together. And there are situations where if the mom's using, and she, you know, if she doesn't have any interest in being involved, there's nothing we're going to do about it. But if she does, look, she may not get her baby now, but that doesn't mean that's forever. And so this is a chance for them to bond and to have that experience going down, and we know it's going to be good for the kids. So we don't do anything differently.
That's great. That's great. Great news. One of the resources that we'll include in the email that comes out to the registrants is a new publication or a new technical assistance tool from the National Center on developing plans of safe care. Many of the participants on the phone today, I'm sure, are familiar with the changes in the Child Abuse Prevention and Treatment Act and the notification that's to happen from hospitals to Child Protective Services when an infant is identified as affected by substance abuse, withdrawal symptoms, or fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. So I think that planning guide will be helpful to many in the audience. And again, we'd encourage you to reach out to us if you'd like some help with any of that. How do you decide when to encourage breastfeeding and when not to?
So that's a good and a little bit complicated question. So we encourage it in cases where mothers are in medication-assisted treatment and compliant. So we always encourage it then. There's no dose restriction or anything like that. And then less so if they're using illicitly or street drugs and then we have some other there's questions about what you're supposed to do with marijuana, and probably our protocols, which I didn't have any involvement in, are probably a little more restrictive than I would like them to be. But we are generally encouraging it, and it's really, look, our and that's the words I would use. It's not up to us, really. Once they go home, you know, we would encourage it when we can, and then we would discourage it. And we would also, one of the things we've tried to do is just be totally honest about things. So we'd say, you know, in terms of like, moms on methadone are going to be sleepier, and so we discuss that with them. And moms who are going to breastfeed, we're going to say, yeah, it's safe. If you start using other things again, it might not be safe, so you should stop breastfeeding them. And so, which is, I think, a reasonable thing to discuss. We're just open about it and not trying to remove the stigma about discussing these things. There's relapse rates with these things, so it's important to discuss. So that's sort of how we look at it. And I think probably most hospitals have some version of that, but it should always be encouraged in folks in compliance with their program.
Were there any changes with the nurse-patient ratios on the general floor when you began moving babies, or not moving them to NICU, but putting them together with moms in the general floor? Did you change the nursing patterns?
No, the nursing patterns have not been changed in the nursery or on the floor. If anyone gets a extra baby, it would be now a NAF baby, which is sort of the opposite of what most people think about it. But we don't. They are not more difficult than any other patient, and in fact, they're easier than most. I think the folks in the nursery who are doing couplet care, they have not changed it. Some of them say, "Well, it's a little more work, but it's okay." But no changes.
Mm-hmm. So a few different questions about the guidelines from American Academy of Pediatrics on the length of time to monitor for NAS symptoms to materialize, if you will, or manifest. And it sounds like, or some of the data look like, you're perhaps not monitoring in the hospital that length. Can you talk about how long you're monitoring babies before discharge? When you're making that determination that those symptoms are sort of resolved and ready to go? Well, I guess that's two different questions. One on, are you discharging before the symptoms, and then second on making that determination about when to send home.
Right. So I don't think we are ever sending home a baby whose symptoms are resolved. That's not our goal. Our goal is to make sure there's going to be a good outcome. So the AAP, there's not a lot of evidence behind the guidelines, and they all say 4 to 7 days for the longer acting ones and 2 to 3 days for shorter acting. I have not seen a kid not have withdrawal signs and then start on day 4 or 5. But our general for the longer acting ones is to look at 5 days plus or minus a little bit. And really our goal is not to see if they're going to have withdrawal. Again, all the kids exposed to methadone are all having withdrawal at that point. And really with buprenorphine, with rare exceptions, not having it. So we're trying to think about, are the parents ready? You know, are they feel confident? Are they doing everything? And that's usually somewhere between 4 and 6 days. If we have a situation where the mom can't be there, she's in a program and they won't let her leave at night, and the baby does great when mom's there and not as good when mom isn't there, we're actually going to discharge that baby sooner because mom's the treatment and she's not here. But it's usually around. So I think we are following those. We're trying to figure out if that's the right amount of time. What we found for our purposes, it is, maybe for a slightly different reason than what they're doing it. We feel like usually within that time, the moms are ready. In some cases, it certainly could be shorter. And I think for C-section babies, they often go home with the mom from the nursery on day 4.
There was a comment kind of / question about, again, back to the involvement of child protective services, that sometimes that particular hospital from the questioner is that they're holding babies for a longer period of time because they don't have a place for the baby and the mom to go, or for the baby to go if there's going to be a placement. So have you run into that? How are you doing that? How are you making those determinations? And I guess the larger question with that is really CPS involvement. Has that relationship changed? Have you had some specific efforts with Child Protective Services? You said that they're more likely to be keeping babies with their mom. What's that look like? Are there specific strategies that you put in place related to CPS?
Not specifically to CPS. We certainly have a good relationship, and they really loved what we've done. And the commissioner of our Department of Children and Families is really, really loves our program. But we haven't done it specifically to affect that. That wasn't really our goal, but I think it's had that impact. In terms of that, we definitely ran into issues as we were starting where there would be this delay of several days when we would be ready to discharge the baby before things would be figured out. And we really made us think about that years ago. And that has not, it's kind of when they start the process. And so they wouldn't start anything until we would say the baby's ready to go. So we sort of knew that, and we've been able to work around that a little bit so that things are really ready to go. We really don't have delays. If we have a delay, it's very rarely, and it's for a day. And that's been working with them and saying, look, it's the same amount of work just when you start doing it. And we don't want these babies, these babies, if they're not going to be with their families, need to be with another family soon. And they saw that and they said, okay, yeah, we can. I mean, it's not any extra work for them. It's just when it starts. So we were able to work with them, and I think we all understood that. So it's really, they've been a nice partner with us.
Great. That's something that we're hearing and encouraging from the National Center on Substance Abuse and Child Welfare. In fact, that monograph that we showed the cover of, the collaborative approach to the treatment with pregnant women with opioid use disorders, has a whole case study written from Burlington, Vermont, and their CHARM collaborative, which works closely with the prenatal clinic so that the plan can be determined before the due date, so that a lot of that crisis at birth that CPS is responding to by getting the call, here's an infant, we have to do a safety assessment. Often there's automatic holds placed on the baby, that there's not going to be a discharge until there is the investigation and the safety plan developed by CPS. So we're mindful of the communities that are working on that very specifically. And again, would encourage participants to take a look at that case study that's in that monograph about how Burlington, Vermont has changed their practice in regard to that, making sure that there's a plan prior to the mom's due date. Which brings up some of that engagement with families in the prenatal period. Do you have a protocol that's been developed, or who's providing that education piece to parents, and particularly the engagement of fathers? What does that look like in that prenatal period on the education to families?
So that's a good question. I'm not sure we're doing, I think other places are doing it better than we are. Some places have done, where they do a pediatric consult, basically, where they'll have either the neonatologist or the hospitalist will meet with the family and go over it. We actually have a nurse practitioner who does it, and we have a whole protocol and handout and information packet that goes with the families. I think our efforts to engage the fathers prenatally, I don't think we've really done much of anything. And I think that's a really good idea to try to figure out how to do that. I'm not sure. I don't know of anyone who has a real focus on that at this point, but it's probably a really nice idea. So we do all this stuff. And there are, you know, of course, our families that we miss and we haven't given them the prenatal education or plan, that we just do it as soon as we can and keep reinforcing it.
One of the other service systems or collaborative partners that become important when there is a notification to Child Protective Services and there's a determination that the baby is not going to stay in the custody of the birth mom are the dependency court judges or the juvenile court judges. Have you had, or is there anything that you can report back about any change in the juvenile court system? Or their awareness, or reach out to them specific to the court processes for these infants?
So I actually can't speak intelligently about that one. I don't know of our changes around here or that. I've not heard anything about that, so I apologize.
No, that's fine. We would again encourage the participants, if you're running into a situation that the juvenile court judges may have a different view from the medical advice from the hospital. Again, we'd encourage you to get in touch with us and see if we might be able to be helpful with some technical assistance for that. For the participants, you've seen the contact information on the screen for quite some time. That's an encouragement to please do be in touch with us if there are questions that are specific that we didn't get to in our time today. We do have some of those that we will try to respond to individually and those that we'll refer on to Dr. Grossman for some of the more clinical practice kinds of issues. Again, we thank you so much for your participation today. We are pleased with the response for the number of registrants for this webinar know that this is a critical issue and appreciate so much Dr. Grossman sharing his knowledge and the whole group that he worked with to change their practice. One final question that I have before we leave came from one of the participants today and said, do you believe this approach is doable across the country?
Yeah, totally. I think this doesn't take any resources. This is actually takes far fewer resources than the traditional approach. It's just treating babies like babies and moms with kind of the respect that they deserve as moms. And it's figuring, you know, there are some problems to deal with, which is mostly how do you keep the mom and baby together in some areas, but those are surmountable problems. So that's really the only thing, and then the rest of it is changing attitudes and the thought process about it. So this is totally doable. There's no real, other than figuring out that problem of how you keep them together. There's really no need for any investment, and it should be a major money saver.
Terrific! Thank you so much, and thank you again to all the participants. We look forward to hearing from you, and appreciate all the work that you're doing on behalf of the nation's children and their families. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.